Good morning, church. I just want to thank Mark and the worship team for bringing us into... Bring us into the Holy of Holies, into His wonderful presence. So, you know, just want to thank God that we really can worship God this morning. And just also want to thank Reverend Lynette for inviting me to share the Word of God in Aldersgate Methodist Church. I'm truly honored and take this very seriously, that God's Word will be preached today. I send you greetings from Barker Road Methodist Church as well. Shall we bow our heads in a word of prayer? Father, Lord, just pray that, Father, Your presence will be here. And that, Father, the Holy Spirit will be the teacher and will just take the words into living words into our hearts. Father, may You be present and help me to share Your word to Your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today's topic, it's blessed are those who hear the word of God. Is there such a thing? Is there such a thing as hearing God's word? Sometimes we don't really hear it about this in churches. Maybe the author or the writer says, blessed are those who read the word of God. Maybe that's more kosher. Or maybe blessed are those who study the word of God. But we maybe seldom really hear about hearing the word of God. Is it really, really possible? And if you don't mind, so that you don't hear this person preaching here and giving you a new doctrine, if you don't mind, we go through quite a few verses in the Bible. Is it okay? All right, so we treat this like a Bible study, if you don't mind. The word is actually taken from Jesus, found in Luke 11:28, which is also a verse that's been given by Trek for Laity Sunday. And it says, but he said, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and keep it. What did Jesus mean? The context of this passage. Actually, I don't mind the feedback, so I can hear myself. The context of this verse is, if you read the whole of Luke 11, Jesus was sharing many wonderful truths, and one of that is actually he was teaching his disciples about the Lord's Prayer. And it was really amazing. It started with Our Father. And later on, he went down to say, ask, and it will be given. Seek, and you will find. And knock, and the door will be open. And he was expounding truth after truth. And then he was also casting out demons. And, of course, the people were saying, oh, he's casting out demons by Beelzebub, who is the prince of demons. And Jesus answered them by saying, if the house is divided, how can it stand? That's the kind of wisdom that Jesus had. He said, if Satan is casting out Satan, then his house is divided, it will not stand. And so he was expounding wisdom and words, and suddenly a lady in verse 27 says, cried out in amazement, oh, he says, blessed is the womb that bore you. Blessed is the breast that you nursed on it. Basically, what the lady was saying is that, blessed is your mother who raised you up and probably taught you all these truths. But Jesus answered very funnily by saying these words, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and keep it. And I believe, and I will go through many of the verses later on, I believe what he meant was that the words that he's been speaking comes from hearing the word of God. Comes from hearing the Father speaking to him and keeping it in his heart and obeying the Lord God Almighty. Now, is this something new that Jesus was expounding? hearing the Word of God. Actually, if you go through the entire Bible, you will find many, many, many passages. Don't believe me? Just Google. And if you find many, 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 many passages on hearing the Word of God, let's see, even from Exodus 15, 26. This is the Lord saying, the Lord is saying, if you will diligently listen to the voice of the Lord, your God, and do that which is right in His eyes, and give ear to His commandments, and keep all His statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you that I put on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord, your God, your healer. What is the context of this verse? And I know that when we preach God's Word, we make sure we don't preach it out of context, especially this topic on hearing the voice of God. So if we look at the whole of Exodus 15, it's a very powerful chapter because it showed the people of Israel had just come out of the Red Sea. They had just come out and they were looking back and they saw how the Red Sea had crushed over the whole Egyptian army. And they were so amazed and they were praising God that they sang what they call the Song of Moses. You know, remember? The horse and rider fell into the sea. That whole passage in Exodus, we were praising God. They saw the mighty acts of the Lord God Almighty. And then they journeyed into the wilderness. And after 3 days, that's where the real test came. After 3 days, what happened? They couldn't find water. And then they found in a place called Mara. And when they found the water, it was bitter. And guess what? After seeing the mighty Red Sea, after seeing the mighty powers of God, they came and water finally, after 3 days, they were thirsty, it was bitter. And they grumbled against Moses. They complained against Moses. And God was so, well, He still cared for people, and He told Moses, put a log, I don't know why, but put a log into this water in Mara, and it became sweet, and the people drank it. And then, out of the blues, He said this verse, saying, if you will diligently listen to the voice of the Lord your God, and do that which is right in His eyes. You know, you would have thought that the Lord would say, people of Israel, you must have more faith in me, right? He would have thought that He would say, after the Red Sea, didn't you see me open the Red Sea? I mean, that's a miracle by itself. And then crushing on the Egyptians, that's another miracle. They were after your tail. And then you came and you said praise to me. And after 3 days, you grumbled. Surely. But instead, He said, if you would diligently listen to the voice of the Lord your God, and do what is right in His eyes. He wants to obey. Perhaps He was saying something to the people of Israel. He says, give ear to His commandments and keep all His statutes, and I will put none of the diseases on you that I put on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord, your healer. Maybe He was telling the people, I want you to listen to me. I want you to have a relationship with me. I want you hear my voice and obey me, and perhaps you will then know that I will protect you from all these diseases. I will be your healer. I will look after you. You don't have to worry. You are safe because I am your healer. I will protect you. But only when you know me and when you listen to me and when you obey me, trust and obey, just now the song. Maybe then we will know our Lord God Almighty. And many times when we go through problems, when we go through issues in life, sometimes all we need is to know who God is, that He is the Almighty God, the maker of heaven and earth, and that nothing is impossible for Him. And maybe that's what God's heart is. He wants us to know Him, to listen to Him. But guess what? You read two chapters later in Exodus 17, the people of Israel again did it. Did what? They were now journeying into the wilderness and they came to Massah and Meribah. And guess what? There was no water. There was no water. And again, guess what? They complained and grumbled against Moses. So God was telling them. And you know God's heart, because later on, you read also in Psalms 95, 7 and 8, and also in Hebrews 3, 15. In the New Testament, the writer of Hebrews used this same incident. And then he said one thing. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in Massah and Meribah, as you did in the day of rebellion. God calls it a rebellion because God had showed them so many things. But the moment they came into trouble, and God is saying, today, if you hear his voice, today, this wonderful morning, when you hear his voice, when you hear his voice, don't freak out, okay? Don't get upset, don't get, but when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. As we did in the day of the rebellion. And he says, give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes. Keep it in your heart, obey him, and I will put none of the diseases on you that I put on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord, your God, your healer. What does it mean, give ear? You know, you find it many, many times when Jesus was telling his parables, he always said one word after that. What was that? He who has a ear, let him hear, right? Why did he say that? In the last book of the Bible, in Revelation, the seven churches, remember? They were teaching, they were prophesying in the seven churches, and it's very relevant for us today. Every time he finished the church, he said one thing. What was that? He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Now, I've always marveled at that because it cannot be that when John was talking, there were a lot of people without ears. I think there were a lot of people with ears. I mean, maybe one or two were deaf, but what does he mean if you have a ear? Let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. Is God talking to us? We all have ears. But he says, give me your ear. Give ear to my commandments. You know, maybe we have a choice. We have 2 ears, but maybe it's up to us to want to listen or we shut him off. You know, the Bible says 2 things that we can do to the Holy Spirit. We can quench the Holy Spirit, or we can grieve the Holy Spirit. No, if we don't want any words from him, he would not press it on us. He would not. He'll just be quenched. He'll just be grieved. But the Holy Spirit will never push his way through into our lives if we don't want him. And so it says, give ear to my commandments and keep my statutes. And then perhaps we will know who the Lord God Almighty is, that he is our healer, that he is our provider, that he is the Lord God Almighty. You know something? The person who really took to this voice of God, who was it that really took his word? Moses. You know Moses in Exodus 33? You know that famous passage? He says, if your presence... You know, the Lord was saying, look, you guys... you know, always disobey me. I will send an angel with you. You can go into the promised land, but I won't be with you. Maybe that's a good deal because they'll still go into the promised land, right? Even with an angel, why not? But Moses wanted the presence of God. Moses really wanted the presence of God, just like, you know, Mark and the worship team brought us into the presence of God, the glory of God. That's where we meet him, in church, where we have a corporate worship. We meet Jesus Christ in this church. And Moses wanted the presence of God. Remember in Exodus 33, I think it's 11, it says, if your presence doesn't go with us, then let us not leave from here. Moses really, really wanted the presence of God. And because of that, you know, Psalms 103, it says that God showed Moses his way, made known his way to Moses, and the deeds to the people of Israel.
Because Moses wanted God's presence. He wanted to have that relationship with God. God showed him his ways. And you read, And when Moses went into the tent of meeting to speak with the Lord, he heard the voice speaking to him from above the mercy seat that was on the Ark of the Testimony and from between the two cherubim, and it spoke to him. Moses really wanted God's presence. He wanted to speak to God, and God spoke to him. That's powerful. That's amazing. You know, how many of us really, really would like God to talk to us, to speak to us? Is it possible in the 21st century, or is it in Moses' days only? Moses was... And Moses, you find right through in the Pentateuch, you know, he was many, many verses always referring to, if you faithfully obey the voice of the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments that I command you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth, and all these blessings shall come upon you and overtake you if you obey the voice of the Lord your God. Well, we must obey, right? But before we obey, we must listen. How do you obey without knowing what God is saying? And it goes hand in hand. We want to obey. We want to please God. We want to, it's not works by, salvation by works, but it is grace. But when we accept the Lord Jesus Christ, our heart just overflows and we obey him. But first of all, before we obey, we must listen. And Moses was very, very clear, if you faithfully obey the voice of the Lord your God. Now, is this all only in the Old Testament? Long gone, past. And now with the New Testament, nothing like this exists, is it? Okay, the famous John 10:3, to him the gatekeeper opens, and him is Jesus, right? The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And verse 4, which is not here, says, and the sheep knows his voice. You know, many times when we hear his voice, there is always that familiar voice. And many times too, he'll call you by name. Don't be surprised. And he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. They know his voice and they follow him. You know, we all are a special people. What do I mean by that? When we accepted the Lord as our Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit lives in us. The Holy Spirit resides in us. And that's where we get our prompting. That's where we hear the voice of God. John chapter 16, verse 13. It's very clear. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own authority, but what he hears, he will speak. And he will declare to you the things that are to come. How does he, the Holy Spirit, declare to us the things that are to come? Through the voice of God. Through the voice of God. So don't be frightened. Don't freak out. It is God still working through the Holy Spirit to us in the 21st century. And I just want to encourage all of us in church. It's really exciting. It's really powerful when we allow the Holy Spirit to declare the things that are to come, to declare what he hears and has. He speaks to us, and we accept that. It's such a wonderful relationship. It's such a powerful relationship every step of the way. And John 10:27, my sheep hear my voice. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. You know, this is powerful. You know, God knows us. You know, the Bible, I find great encouragement when it says, God knows the number of hair that we have. Can you imagine? He knows the number of hair that we have. I mean, can you imagine? It's really wonderful. And he even fashioned us even when before we were in our mother's womb. Can you imagine? And it's not just for Moses. It's just not for all those big champions, you know. It's for all of us. And you know, when God knows us and he speaks to us, that's what that wonderful and powerful relationship it is. You know, we are not alone. We are not alone. And those of us in the workplace, I'm sure churches do have their issues, right? Or everything's okay in church. But anyway, those in the workplace, it's not easy. Yeah? Or am I the only one? It's not easy, right? I mean, I used to say that, you know, in a corporate world, if you do well this year, next year, you have to do better. Wow, how come you know the answers? You do well next year you got to do better. Where does it stop? C'est la vie, but that's the world for us, right? But we're not alone. Because Jesus says, I know you. I know you. I formed you. You're special. And each and every one of us, whether we're in church, we're in a workplace, he has put us there for a reason, for our purpose. You know? And they follow me. And you know who really, really took to this? This person called Paul. You know, he was on the road to Damascus, remember? And the light shined on him, and he heard a voice, and he says, you know, Paul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, who are you, Lord? I'm Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Right? Remember that? And then he said, what do you want me to do? And he says, okay, you go to Damascus, there you meet a man called Ananias, and he will tell you what is appointed for you to do. So exactly what did Jesus say to Paul when Ananias met Paul? Go and preach to 10,000 people. Go and throw your handkerchief and everyone will be healed. Go and heal miracles, mighty, mighty miracles. What? Acts 22, Paul himself was relating through that incident. If you read the Acts 22, he tells you the story from the time that he was entering into the road of Damascus. And when he met Ananias, Ananias told him, the God of our fathers appointed you to preach to 10,000 people, is it? The God of our fathers appointed you to know his will, to see the righteous one, to hear a voice from his mouth. I mean, that sounds kind of wimpy, right? But, you know, it's not like those big, huge vision statements, go, go, go. God appointed him to know his will. God appointed him to see Jesus. And God appointed him to hear a voice from the Lord. Obviously, Paul did mighty, mighty miracles. Paul preached to tens and thousands, but I believe before he obeyed and went off to do that, he had to know God. He had to know God, God's will. He had to see God. He had to hear God. You know, and I really, really ask and sense that I believe that the Lord wants us in church. Let's just meet him. Let's spend that time. Let's just ask him what his will is for us, because it's powerful. It's powerful when he reveals his will for each and every one of us. When he speaks to us face to face, when we hear his voice, it's powerful. Even Jesus said these words, you know, when Satan tempted him and wanted him to turn the rocks into bread, remember? And he says, man shall not live by bread alone. And he's, of course, referring to the sustenance physically, which is important. But he says also, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. This is the spoken word of God, Rima. And he is saying that, Jesus is just saying that besides the bread that sustains physical life, he lives by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And Paul, too, continues to say, faith comes from hearing. You know, when we hear God and we will obey him, and suddenly we know he's alive. and our faith arises. Faith comes from hearing, and hearing from the Word of God, from the Word of Christ, Rhema, hearing the spoken words of Jesus. I remember when I was traveling one day, and I travel about 60% of the time, and one day I was in my hotel room, and as I was being quiet before the Lord just spoke to me, you know, pray for your wife. Pray for your wife. My beautiful wife is right there behind, and I'm going to embarrass her, but I didn't tell her I'm going to share this, but okay, still okay? Okay, so I just fell on my knees because I didn't know what was wrong. I just fell on my knees, and I just kept praying in tongues, and I just, Lord, what's happening? Lord, just keep her and, you know, shield her and protect her. When I came back from my trip, I just shared with her. I said, you know, the Lord just gave me the impression. In fact, it was in a small group, and I said, I shared about the Lord giving me the impression, and I fell on my knees and was just praying for you. And she said, "What? When was that?" And you know, she went back and says, "Yeah, that was the time. My mother-in-law, her mom, had to go through a operation from her heart, and she was seeing her mom, and even through the wee nights, you know, in the hospital. And at that point that I was spoken to pray, she was driving and almost fell asleep. And the Lord placed in my heart to pray for her. You know, the Lord cares. The Lord has mercy. He is an amazing God. And now, when she shared that, the thing that came in my heart was my faith arise that the Lord is a living God. He is alive, and He is the Almighty God. And yet, He cares for each and every one of us. You know, the Lord does care. And I just pray that our faith from hearing will arise. Sometimes though, His voice is pretty soft. And you know, we lead very busy lives, isn't it? Sometimes we get up in the morning, by the time we finish at night, we say, what happened? Finish, day is gone. You know? It's not just me, right? Okay. So, but you know, it's true. You know, in this famous 1 Kings chapter 19, you know all about Elijah. In Elijah, you know, he did great battles, and he won the battle against all the prophets of Baal. But suddenly, he ran away because Jezebel, the queen of Ahab, threatened him. And he ran. He was so discouraged. He said, Lord, just take my life. But the Lord took care of him and fed him and brought him back to health, and then he says, come out, I will talk to you. And it's amazing, this passage, because it's almost like the Lord is pressing on a point. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountains, broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. It's almost like an emphasis, no? And after the wind and earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, the fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. It's almost as though it was placed there to emphasize and emphasize and emphasize. And finally, after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. Now, a whisper is low, whisper is soft enough, right? How does a low whisper sound like? I don't know, but it's really, really soft, okay? And sometimes we lead so busy lives, you know, we don't stop enough to hear God. We don't stop enough to hear God. You know, things just go so fast. Before you know it, it's the nighttime. And then you live morning, go to work, nighttime. Morning, go to work, nighttime. Weekend, yay. Right? But it's so fast. And sometimes his voice is so low. You know, I used to have a Sunday school teacher called Tangi Por. And, you know, I respect him a lot. You know, he's gone, you know. But every time I see him, he's such a peaceful man. And I ask him, Gipo, do you ever get problems in life? You know, I mean, yeah. And he said, yeah, I do. And I said, what do you do? He said, I take a half-day leave, and I go to East Coast, and I, you know, I meet with God. And I tell you, ever since he said that, you know, all my staff knows, Michelle, where you are anyway, all my staff knows that if I take half a day, he says, oh, Chirping Sam's got problems, he's meeting God, you know. I'll take a half a day, and I'll just go East Coast, West Coast, whatever you call it, what coast, I'll just pick a place, and I'll just spend time with God. And it's lovely. You know, when we are at our wit's end, have you gone through that? When you tried all you can, but you just say, Lord, oh man, I can't do it. And you come before God, and you meet God. You know, I tell you, it's wonderful because God cares. God really cares. You know, and I believe that Jesus did the same thing. I really believe he did the same thing because I'm very encouraged when I read Mark 1:35. And rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed, went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. Even Jesus spent time with God. It could be that low, small voice, but he went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed to God. And I believe that's where he spoke to God. I believe that's where he heard God. It's not in the Bible, but I believe it's in there. You know, and Psalms 46 is so powerful, isn't it? The psalmist could easily have said, know that I'm God. He used the word be still. Be still and know that I'm God. And many times we just need to do that. You know, our life is just like a just now, Reverend Lynette was praying, and she's saying we're like a hamster or something. You know, we're just going on this wheel. Life is so fast. Maybe sometimes we should just stop and be still, and know that He is God. You know, and sometimes that's all we need to know that He is in control. He's the sovereign Lord. You know, and I like this too in Psalms 1, 2, and 3. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. Sorry, I'm just going to rush a little bit. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law, he meditates day and night. And I think it's important. Because even when we start to hear God's word, the Holy Spirit will never contradict the Bible. The Holy Spirit inspired the Bible. The Holy Spirit will never contradict the Bible. And when we meditate his word day and night, and when we hear his voice, then we know that it's aligned to his word. We know there is peace. We know that he is speaking to us. And God also spoke to Joshua. When Moses died, God spoke personally to Joshua. And what are the first few things he said to Joshua? This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night. You know, the Proverbs very wisely put it, my son, be attentive to my words. You know, and when we meditate on the word, we are being attentive because we set aside some time. You know, it's not like, you know, you ask people, how long? 15 minutes. No, that's no good. You know, you've got to be holy. Spend 1 hour. I mean, that's fine, right? But it's not for that reason that we want to spend time with God. It's really spending time with God unrushed, and you say, Lord, you know, this is my time with you. You know, I just want to be with you. And you go into this word, and suddenly you ask the Holy Spirit to pick it up, and the words just, the words come out, you know, and it applies to your life. It applies to my life. And it says, incline your ear to my saying. So it's not only being attentive, but inclining our ear. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. We can incline our ear, you know. But it'd be great if we don't rush. And every time our meetings, if it's 8:30 or 9, I always set an hour back, you know. And this hour is precious. And I would just use that hour and just go up to God. And it's beautiful, it's wonderful. I just encourage church, you will not regret it. And lastly, I just want to share some application. You know, when we spend time with God and meditate, there are times, you know, it helps when you journal. Okay, I'm a very visual person, so maybe some are not. So whatever works for you, but what really works for me is journaling. You know, I got really cupboards full of, really, of all my journals. I'm surprised my wife hasn't taken me out on that one, but I got lots of journals, and every time in the morning when I spend time with him, whichever country I am in, I would just write to him. And it was almost like a love letter, and I'll just write everything. I just talk to God and just write. And I say, Lord, I'm going through this issue, and, you know, it's going to be tough because, and I don't know what to do. You know, walk with me, just help me. You know, and just spending time and allowing him to speak back. And many times, you know, please don't freak out when I say that. You know, I'll hear Peng Sam, and he'll say things to me, and I'll write it down. You know, of course, it has to be based on the Word of God. And so, and at night, when I do go through my journals, it's amazing. You know this word, when you see the hand of God in our lives, you know what's that? When things happen and you know it's not us, it's not our wisdom, it's not our brains, it's not what we do, it's not by coincidence, but by the hand of God, that things are working the way it is. You know something? That's when you know God is alive. It's not a coincidence. He is alive. And sometimes by going through the journal, our faith arises. Because he's a personal God. He's not far away. He's not somebody out there shouting some laws out there. He is a personal God. You know?